Welcome to Cybersecurity Tips, Tools, and Techniques. I'm Ron Woerner. We're ready to have a rocking and rolling good time this week. It's a long week here at RSA. Mike, if you could unfreeze. Let's see, are we unfrozen? There we go. This is my bio. I'm not going to take any time. Look me up. Connect with me on LinkedIn. Blah, 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 blah. I've been doing this for a while. These are my thoughts. Use at your own risk. I checked out most of these websites, or all of these websites, the tools, the resources, etc. But you never quite know. Links break. Things change over time. By the way, if something does change, let me know. This slide deck will be available, if it's not already, through the conference site, so you don't have to have your phone out. I do this under the Creative Commons. I share it just to share the knowledge. This is my list of all the different tools I've collected over time as a cybersecurity educator and practitioner. I work as a consultant for small, medium businesses, as well as a state government agency. They don't have much money, do they? Who here likes free stuff? Okay. This is exercise, by the way. We're all going to go down to the vendors, right, and get all that swag, the t-shirts, the socks, right? That's my idea. How do we keep security affordable? Because if I go to the chief financial officer and say, hi, sir, we need $2 million for this security tool, yeah, right. So my thoughts, use your own risk. Please let me know if you find any broken links. And I'm going to be switching in and out. I'm going to be running and showing a lot of demos. The one thing I'm going to ask of you at the end is if you know a tool that I missed or a technique, please share it with others. I have a blog on this on Peerlist, so you can share it there as well. Let's jump right into it. What are we doing here? Well, none of us have an unlimited budget, do we? So we'll go back here. I work with high school students as part of US Cyber Patriot, and I teach them how to use these tools. We want to make sure we're using the right tools at the right time in the right place for the right reasons. That's what I'm here to help you understand. My goal out of this is to show you maybe just a couple of things you had never seen before. Okay? That's invariably what happened. I never knew that existed, and then you can use it. The easiest hack, though, can't forget our humans, of course. That's social engineering. I heard it throughout sessions yesterday that I attended. We can't forget about the human element. So often the easiest way, the easiest tip, trick, technique. So I have the solution for social engineering and phishing, by the way. And it costs nothing. Free. Hey, Randy, I just got this really weird email that wants my bank number. What do you think? Do it. Okay. Thank you. Send it to you. That's it. If you see something, say something. Ask somebody else. Okay? It's okay. You might appear silly. You know, why are you asking me? Hey, that little technique. If you only remember one slide, though. Because I know some of you are going to like, you know, there's a lot of other cool sessions I want to bug out. So I didn't do it. Not my fault. Anyway, these are great resource sites right here. Stay Safe Online, the National Cybersecurity Alliance, through the Department of Homeland Security. Same thing with DHS. If you see something, say something. So if you have no money for security awareness, you can leverage this. National Cybersecurity Awareness Month is October. Stay Safe Online provides free posters, newsletters. You can put your own logo on them and distribute them. They're cool with that. So great resources right here for security awareness. Anyone have any other resources you want to shout out? Okay, if you think of any, let me know. Number one hacking tool in the world is... Y'all know how to do the advanced search, right? So let's pull that up. Right here, make this bigger. So I wanted to find out where at the RSA site they were talking, where presentations on AI, machine learning. So I did look it up on rsa.com, and I'm looking for PDFs. Boom. Am I on the RSA site right now? Nope, I'm on Google. Google's the vacuum cleaner of the internet. And even if RSA doesn't have it, you see this green arrow no one knows what to do with? It says cached on it. I can pull up the Google version of it. So even in, because that's happened, right? You go out to a website and it's like, oh, they pulled the information. Once something's on the internet, it's there forever, right? So one of my, I'll show you on the slide and we'll jump to it. The internet is a time machine. Archive.org, the Wayback Machine. Here we go right here. So I'm gonna say, let's look at the, did I lose my network? I have lost my network again. I'm just on the Wi-Fi, you get the idea. I could pull it up and you can see these sites going back to 1999. So you can see how RSA conference has changed over the last 20 years. Who here has used Wayback Machine? So a few. The rest, if you didn't raise your hand, then something else kind of cool. And this is rapid fire, by the way. I go through a ton of free stuff. Make this a little bigger. SecTools. If you just want a list, where do I go for the list? And there's plenty of seats along the side, middle. Please come on in, make yourself comfy. Make this bigger. So the top 125 network security tools, sectools.org, Wireshark, Metasploit. There's one tool not on this list. Anyone know what it is? NMAP. Because Fyodor, who created this list, didn't want to corrupt it, so he didn't put his own tool on it. I still use NMAP a lot today to do my network mapping and just do some basic recon on a network. Let's see, HowDoGeek. I love HowDoGeek. By the way, these are my opinions. I'm not paid to say any of this. It's just stuff I use all the time. So if I'm looking how to do something, I'll often find an article on HowDoGeek. I'll point out an example here coming up in a little bit about setting up a virtual machine. So if you haven't used HowDoGeek, check it out. Oh, any gamers in the room? I work with kids. And all the kids, it's okay, raise your hand if you're a gamer. You know, Fortnite. Actually, I've never played Fortnite, but I'm old. It's a way to connect with the kids. So Humble Bundle is a gaming site. And you're going, what does that have to do with what you're talking about? They actually sell books, too. For what, 20 bucks, 15 bucks, you get all of these books. They often have about 2 to 3 times a year series of cybersecurity books, hacking books, the ones you'll find out on the showroom floor. Great way to find free information. Older geeks, how do geeks, top security tools. The slides are available. I'm not going to click on everything. That's for your homework. National Institute of Standards and Technology. They are becoming the gold standard, I've learned. For those who want to take pictures, I can go full screen. You don't get fired for following NIST. Seems to be the prevalent ideas today with all the different standards out there. So use them. But the Center for Internet Security, I was talking in line with a gentleman earlier today and saying, hey, what do you think about Center for Internet Security, their CSF, their benchmarks, their risk analysis tool? Anyone here use Center for Internet Security? So if you need to lock down a system, you can check them out. If you're wondering, how do I perform a risk assessment? Free. The MSISAC provides a lot of free alerting. You can get the Multi-State Information Sharing and Analysis Center as a part of the Center for Internet Security, which is great working for a state government. The Defense Intelligence Agency has their STIGs. By the way, STIG is also not only a noun, but a verb. Did you STIG that machine? Right? Did you lock it down? They have the guides on how to lock it down. So it's like, okay, you need to secure that Windows server. All right, what the heck does that mean? How do I do that? Pull the STIG out on it. Matrix is also another good tool on how to lock down machines. I have all of these. I'm not going to pull them all up. Doing an inventory. Who here has a good inventory of all of their systems on their network? Three? You get, how many are like this? You have five different numbers of the number of Windows systems you have. You know, it's like, oh, you know, Microsoft thinks we have this much. Our AV thinks we have this much. Well, again, common idea is you can't secure what you don't know about. That's also why I use NMAP, just to do partly that inventory. There's lots of other tools out there as well. Cheat sheets, let me pull some of these up. It's really ironic that I'm a college professor who kind of digs cheat sheets. Oh, this is the CSAT, let's see. That's that. Here's the peer list blog of InfoSec related cheat sheets. Oops. Sorry, I'm trying to see if you can see them. A whole bunch of them. They're a rabbit hole, by the way. This is, you know, like Alice in Wonderland. You begin clicking on one and you go to another and it's like, wow, so much free information. Lenny Zeltzer, one of my heroes in information security, wrote a bunch of cheat sheets. Writing tips. Knowing how to write is very important as part of our career, correct? If you can't communicate, managing IT products. Where's my favorite one? Analyzing, he does a lot with malware analysis, troubleshooting human communications. My favorite, where's my favorite RFP? There you go, how to suck at information security. I use this one a lot. No, all in good fun, right? OWASP, Open Web Application Security Project. How many of you are developers, app dev, DevSec, DevSecOps? So, how many of you work with developers? How many of you know developers? How many of you have a developer in your company? Make sure they know OWASP, please. I keep meeting new developers who have no clue, I do have that right here, who OWASP is. Free, and I'll get back to OWASP here in a little bit, a whole bunch of free stuff with OWASP as well. Cheat sheets. All right, let's dive into some tools. How many of you have a VM on your PC? Awesome. What we want to do, not only for yourself, because it's a great way to create your own playground, teach others. I do a lot of teaching even in the high schools, showing high school students how to create their own virtual labs. This way they stop hacking the school's network and the school's computers. I tell them, go hack yourself, and they dig that. So I have both VMware, workstation, oops, that one there, with some. I didn't start any of them up. Great way to run some of the Linux distros, I'll show. Between that, even Windows. If you run Mac OS, Parallels, paid program. Are there any other good tools for Mac out there? Sometimes I don't run a Mac. I've never had the benefactor to provide me with one. And actually, so I'm going to jump down. One thing I hate about PowerPoint is that it's not really hyper-linkable. I think it's, what is it, 26? There we go. If you're looking for good Linux lists of where do I find Linux, distrowatch.com or livecdlist.com. You know, it has the Fedora, the Linux Mint, Ubuntu, all of those fun flavors. And back to our regular show. NMAP, already mentioned, use this quite a bit. How many of you have NMAP on your machine? So, good. How many of you used it to scan your home network? Cool. Do you ever have that OSM? You know, that O moment? You know, I'll give it to my students as an exercise, the college students I work with, and I'm like, yeah, just scan your home network. And they're like, oh my gosh, all my neighbors are using my Wi-Fi. So, by the way, I saw on LinkedIn, Chris Roberts, known for Hacking United, has a Pineapple Wi-Fi running. And if you don't know what Pineapple Wi-Fi is, look it up. Basically fabricates wireless. And he's, you know, making it look like there's a whole bunch of other Wi-Fi that might not be quite legit. So just be aware of using Wi-Fi. If you don't have, or if you do only have an iOS or an Android device, there's Fing you can do, use. It's an app. High school students pointed me to this app. Shows once you're connected, who else is connected on that network. You can see what operating systems they are running. So any of your friends, you know, you can see their phones wide open. This helps make the case for security as often as anything else. When I go into a business and they're like, yeah, why should we care? Okay, well, this is what I saw out in your parking lot before I walked in the door. This is what I found out from the internet before I ever came in. Using Shodan. Any Shodan users out there? I do have a, again, I lost my internet. Probably someone took down the internet. I looked up the university where I teach, just to pick, you know, I only pick on people I'm allowed to pick on, and it shows what's available from the internet, what the internet sees on these different sites. You can do it for URLs, you can do it for IP addresses. You can look for open IoT, open webcams. I've done it to see IIS that's running or Apache to do that external view. Now with Shodan, without paying for it, you're limited. So it is a somewhat pay-for service, so let the buyer beware. But it's good to provide that initial look, give you that indicator. Because if you see a site that seems to be leaking a whole lot of information, you'll see it here. You might not be able to get all of the information without paying for it, but it tells you where to begin to look. And that showed Ann. Census does something similar. I've used it as well. So between Census and Shodan, to be able to see what's on the internet, particularly legacy things. Who here has problems with legacy servers, systems, internet sites? Common challenge. So I've used this to show that, yeah, we still are dealing with legacy. The Qualys SSL scan. I have no relationship to Qualys, I just use the tool. Careful with saying that. I was the client of a law firm, and they wanted me to send their, or wanted me to send my credit, my tax information to them through their portal. So I checked out their portal on SSL Labs. And let's just say it didn't do too well. This was a few years ago, yeah. Susceptible to the Poodle and some of the other common SSL 3.0 attacks. And so I showed them. They were not quite aware. This is also good for compliance. I've used this as part of PCI audits, be able to show that, yes, TLS 1.2 is in place. This is one of those tools that's accessible from anywhere on the internet. So if they say, well, why would they, you know, why should I care? Business leaders are often asked. Anyone else ever get asked that from a business leader? Why should I care? This shows them that any of your clients, customers can pull this up and see what grade you're getting on the internet for free. Vulnerability detection. So there's stars by a few of these because they are not necessarily free. Okay, so be aware. Some of these, like SolarWinds, has a few free tools available, like a firewall to check your firewall from outside IP addresses, etc. But it's very limited in scope. But if you need to audit your firewall, that's often the challenge, right? With firewall rules, they just grow and grow and grow over time. You don't necessarily stop to audit them. Because who wants to read through 1,000 lines of a firewall rule set, right? I mean, there's automated tools you can use. There are some here. Anyone use any of these? So, a few. Now on to the fun, other fun ones. Windows. Who here has an Aunt Sally or Uncle Joe in your life? They come up to you and they say, my computer is running slow. Can you help me? I love asking this to the kids, and everyone's raising their hands. It's like we all have that. For me, it's my mom. She lives up in Michigan. You know, this isn't working on my computer. And it's like, okay. So I keep this around. Or you get a brand new computer, and you get a whole bunch of crapware installed on it, right? So let's look at SysInternals Suite. The tool I'm using, by the way, to zoom is called just the Zoom It tool. Really kind of cool, right? Let's see, auto runs. I should have started this up before. There we go. Showing what's automatically started. You know, you have those programs that automatically start and you don't know how to get them to stop. Auto runs, you just check the box. Checks through registry, checks through all the different startup items. Process Explorer, Task Manager kind of sucks, right? We all know that. Process Explorer is Task Manager on steroids. Where is it? There we go. Sorry. Wrong one. Give it a minute to start up. It'll go into more depth. One of the favorite talks that I've seen, I don't know if he's speaking here this year. You can see what comes up with Process Explorer. This talk here, Mark Rusinovich. Mark Rusinovich wrote these tools a long time ago, just because as a Windows system administrator, he wanted better tools, so he wrote his own. Yes, he does know more about Windows than all of us. Watch his talk on malware hunting. He gave it here at RSA like 6 years ago. And what fascinated me, it was in a room like this, it was completely packed. In the room was Kevin Mitnick and Adi Shamir. So the top minds in cybersecurity were learning from him. It's a fun tool because the way malware often works is it'll work in pairs. So you might kill off the task that you see, but it has a buddy that's watching for it and will resurrect it. So you need to be able to kill off both tasks at the same time. I'm giving a 20-second synopsis of what he covers in about an hour. Pardon me? Yeah, Process Hacker, that is another good tool, yes. And thanks, and that's exactly why I do this, is to share all of these tools. God Mode, who here has God Mode running on their or on their desktop. So I have it right here in the middle of the island. Why go through the control panel? Why point and click when you can use shortcuts like this, right? Even better, learn how to script all of this. Oh, and this is the string for God Mode. I usually just keep it in a text document because I never remember it. Oops, already been through that. Here we go. A tool I loved, it still works, they just don't guarantee it, is MBSA, the Microsoft Baseline Security Analyzer. Been depreciated, it will tell you if you have policies that might be weak, it tells you if you're out of date with patching and updates on your Windows system. Been depreciated, so now it's been substituted by the Windows Update Agent. Also free, so if you have a bunch of systems, are they staying patched? You can use WUA, PowerShell, script everything. You might as well. How many of you are Linux folks in here, though? Do we have a few? I got really excited when I saw this. Make this big, and I'm going to make it go away in a second. Are you running your Linux or Windows subsystem for Linux? It's not actually a Linux kernel. It just allows you to run Linux commands on a Windows box. So if you know how to do things in Linux, like grep, I want to be able to grep and awk through files. Now you can do that. And if you don't know what that is, check out some of the Linux sites. How to Geek, the HTG article on how to launch this. I told you I loved How to Geek. So let's see, I do have, thought I started up, there we go. So that's it here. So you can actually see Linux on Windows. And yes, I created a file. I was hoping to see anyone notice there is a hacker file out there. Anyone else try running this on Windows? So a few. Usually people in the back of the room. Let's see. Nynite, I'll use this more for home systems, not business systems. If it's a new computer, I'll use Nynite to install a whole lot of software that I want to install at once. I'll use Nynite to keep it up to date as well. A student pointed this out to me. It's kind of a nice centralized way, rather than going into each tool separately. I've been to clients, and they pointed me to Batch Patch and Chocolaty. How do we stay up to date on patching? And I see a nodding of a head for Chocolaty right here, which is thank you, because that confirms what I'm seeing. Chocolaty, I do believe, is still free. So seeing the nodding, and I last checked last month. So if you have an organization, it's available on GitHub. And of course, Wireshark. One of the go-to tools for network admins as well as security. I don't know why a site is being blocked or a service is being blocked. Run Wireshark on it, and you can see it. I don't know if my encryption is working or any auditors in the room? Okay, good. No one wants to admit they're an auditor. I don't blame you. If I'm doing an audit and I need to prove that the traffic is encrypted, I'll run Wireshark, and because I can't read anything, it shows that it provides proof that, yes, that traffic is encrypted. I already pointed out the distro sites for Linux. I gave a talk for Beyond Trust on locking down Linux. That's what this link is here. It's actually based on a talk I started in 2000 on a Unix security checklist, and they asked me if I could re-give it. So if you're wondering, what steps do I take to lock down a Linux server? Because Linux runs the internet, right? If you're learning Linux, if you don't know about it, check out that's how to do the geek stuff. The gentleman who runs this site has a lot of really cool free books, tools out there, blogs on Linux. I just kind of stumbled on one day trying to teach some students about Linux. And of course, there's the security distros, Kali, Parrot, Tails. I did not start these up. There's lots of other talks going into a lot more depth on these. But I just wanted to let you know that there are these distributions out there. I'd not only keep them on VMware, but I'll put them on a USB drive. That way, if I'm asked to perform forensics on a box, I can plug in my USB drive, change the BIOS to boot from the USB drive, and be able to make copies of the disk and work on those copies as part of an investigation. Of course, Metasploit, got to keep that in a list. Similar story, I'm not going to go into any details on how to use Metasploit. If you want to learn about Metasploit, there's a good book on Metasploit by Dave Kennedy, Jim O'Gorman. It's actually part of the Cybersecurity Canon Hall of Fame, one of their Hall of Fame books. Recommend just picking that up. It's not very expensive either, like $20 or something. Social engineering, any human hackers out there? Oh, come on. Everyone should be raising your hand. We all should be human hackers. It's the easiest hack I started out with, right? Here are some of the sites that I've used as part of social engineering, because organizations don't understand the information they leak out on the internet. So the open source intelligence tools. One I found out from Chris Hadnagy, the human hacker. Spiderfoot told me all of the open files for web servers for an organization where I was performing an audit and an assessment. They did not realize that they had a whole bunch of PDFs from 2010 out there still totally accessible off of the internet until I showed them the Spiderfoot results. Spiderfoot is available out on GitHub and is free. Multigo paid for, but you can also use to pull a lot of good information as to what's open on the internet. If you want to aggregate geolocation information, like you have pictures and you want to be able to track where someone has gone, the creepy site, and then the peek you. If you want to learn about somebody, you know, you're investigating a particular individual, what information about that individual is available? I actually had a student who used this against Warren Buffett, you know, one of the richest guys in the world, to see what info Warren was leaking. And you can easily find Warren Buffett's home address. He still lives in the same house in the middle of Omaha. What other social engineering tools are you familiar with? Social-engineer.org, a site I'll often use, from Chris Hadnagy. Of course, the social engineering toolkit, Dave Kennedy's. So if you want to run your own phishing campaign, you can use SET, freely available. He's been working on it for a number of years. I believe that's the QR code for it, simulating spear phishing. Use it to create the payload, the launcher. So how do you get the email out? What do you do when they click the link? So creating that back-end website for them to connect to as well. You can do all of this through SET. Security testing, application testing, dynamics, static testing. Of course, there's tools you can purchase for it. The OWASP ZAP, free from OWASP, that does dynamic testing, so it does not actually go into the code. You run it against the website, and it'll tell you if it's vulnerable to cross-site scripting, injection attacks, buffer overflows, all of those OWASP top 10. Burp Suite, I've talked to application security pen testers. That's primarily what they use. You see there's a star by it. Does have a trial version, which is very limited. And then Infection Monkey. But really the one, and I'm going to pull back up the OWASP site, because this is so very valuable. Numerous different pen testing tools. So not only ZAP, but the OWTF, Security Shepherd. You can create your own vulnerable websites to practice on as well. And the OWASP folks are really fun. One of the people I recommend you follow who works with OWASP, Tanya Janka, she's speaking here at the conference. She hacks purple is her Twitter, because she's not quite red team or blue team. She's both, she's purple team, which I think is very appropriate. I've talked to companies that often look for red or blue, and it's like, well, what about the people who can do both? There's not a whole lot. Don't have to identify one over the other. Forensics, just to mention some of the forensics tools. Of course, Encase, you have to pay for. Deft is a Linux distribution, so I might keep, or do keep that on a thumb drive as well. A hex editor, a good hex editor, to be able to just look at files. Quick poll, and I don't have my official poll. How many of you use a password manager? Many of us today, right? We encourage our family to. So here's the list that I've created. Of course, there was an article that came out, particularly with LastPass, KeePass, potentially vulnerable. I mean, you're putting all your eggs in one basket, right? But I still recommend to my friends and family that they use it. Just create that really robust front door, making sure there's no back doors in there. I mentioned the attorneys who said, yeah, email me your tax returns. And I went, no. Why, don't you trust me? No, I just don't trust anyone, particularly attorneys. But anyway, so I pointed out, can I 7-zip it and send it to you? What's 7-zip? I'm like, ooh, I'm so glad you asked. 7-zip comes, where do I have it? I had it running. Anyway, we'll just go back here. Anyway, comes with AES 256 encryption. So we came up with a password over the phone. I 7-zipped it, sent it to him, and he was able to decrypt it using free version of 7-zip. There's other tools, AES Crypt does something similar. You can use Veracrypt, which is the follow-on to TrueCrypt. Of course, there's BitLocker, which hopefully you're all using BitLocker on your laptops. That should be no-brainer at this point. But if you need to send files, Poor man's encryption, I get it. But for an organization that doesn't have any money and wants to email personal information externally, this could be a very inexpensive solution. As a professor, I am often asked, how do I get a job in cybersecurity? What do I need to do? Of course, there's this certification. So it takes three things to get a job, period, not only in cybersecurity, but as well. It takes education, where you learn how to learn. You learn the critical thinking. It takes that training and certifications, where you learn more point knowledge. How do I run a firewall? How do I run Linux? How do I do Windows Server? And then you have experience, okay? Showing your hands-on that you can work in a business. CyberSeek shows all the different security careers, part of the NIST, National Initiative for Cybersecurity Education, NIST, NICE. So if you have someone young in their life and they go, oh, I want to be a hacker. It's like, yeah, I love being a hacker too, right? But it takes a lot of experience, and sometimes it can be boring going through all of those logs. But check out CyberSeek, LinkedIn Learning, Cybrary have a lot of free videos out there, and that's why I'm pointing them out. If you like to read, check out the Cybersecurity Canon. This is run by Palo Alto, full disclosure, but Rick Howard, who runs this, is completely business agnostic when it comes to it. He just loves to read. So what we do is we review books. I'm one of the book reviewers for the Cybersecurity Canon. We have a Hall of Fame. So if you go, anyone ever ask, well, what book should I be reading in cybersecurity? This is the top books that we look at, the Practical Unix and Internet Security, Garfinkel and Spafford, the Bruce Schneier books, the Security Engineering is a new one. I mentioned the Metasploit. What else? What tools did I miss? Invariably, I'll have someone come up after the session and say, you didn't talk about this tool. You're right, that's why I love to give this. I love to learn. Yes, and if you can stand up to the microphone too, please.
There's an alternative to Metasploit, because most of the attacks in Metasploit doesn't work anymore. It is detectable because the signatures are known. And the tool that is available right now is text-based, and it's called Traverse C.
Traverse C.
Yep.
Okay, thank you for pointing that out. I still work with a lot of legacy, and it's amazing how often Metasploit still works. But it's good to know for the newer businesses, the Traverse C. Is that free? It is free, okay. Good. Thank you for sharing that. What other tools, tips, tricks, or is there a question you have? Please step up to the mic. Sorry.
WinFE.
Pardon me?
WinFE.
WinFE, yes.
It's on WinPE, but allows you to do write blocking.
Write blocking, that's right. I forgot, for forensics. So there's always the tools that I then remember because I saw them like 5 years ago. Any others that you have? Yes, sir. Notepad++, PBEdit, yep. Anyone have Notepad++ on their thumb drive? Yep. I mean, you can use that. Thank you for bringing that up. There's a lot of little tools like that we often don't think about that come in really handy when we need them. Yeah. And what is that again?
Arachne,
yes. Meerkat, yep. There's so many good tools out there, which is why it's important to share the different tools, why I like getting out and giving this talk. So thank you for adding to the list. This is now the apply slide. What I'm going to challenge you to do over the next week or two, I know there's so much information at this conference. Pull back up the slide deck. Again, my goal was that you found one or two nuggets that you had never been familiar with. And you have something to pull up and look at. Try it out, play, experiment. In 4 to 6 weeks, pull it back up. See what other tools that could be useful to you. Share the list with others if they are looking for a particular tool tip or technique. The only way we'll solve this problem is by working together, sharing information. Experiment with them. Go back and remember the awareness websites, the Stay Safe Online, Stop, Then Connect. Take part in the Twitter chats they often have as well. So go share these. So this has been Cybersecurity Tips, Tools, and Techniques. If you have other questions, I will take them now. If not, feel free, connect with me on Twitter or LinkedIn. If you have a friend who wasn't able to make this session, I'm actually giving a repeat this afternoon because it tends to be pretty popular. Appreciate your attention. Hopefully you got one or two techniques, and go have a safe week in San Francisco.